believe that the explanation is prepaid expenses. And it's from last year. That number comes from the, when the accountants do the adjustments, when they do the review for the previous year, that's what sits there until they do the next round of adjustments.
If you think we need to know it before once a year, then...
And what it is that it's money we have, but it's
from
in,
the prior
in non-spendable
year.
Form
okay.
from prior
I
year.
Understand.
Yes.
Thank you.
Any other questions? I don't want to rush us on this. When anybody's ready to make
a
motion
to approve
it.
I'll second this.
Moved by Jeffrey, seconded by Barry Miller to approve the treasurer's report, the financial report. Any further discussion? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The motion carries. Thank you, Julie and Barry. Director's report. That's new.
Sorry, this didn't go out before the meeting. So we've started the process of digitizing the Woodstock Times through, we're outsourcing it to a company in Iowa. It's extremely exciting. We're starting at the beginning, so we've done the first 6 years. That's the website where you can find it, and it's scanned from the microfilm, so it's PDF, and the most exciting part is that it's fully searchable, which the Woodstock Times doesn't have an index, so people call and say, I think so-and-so died and whenever, and then you have to look through the whole year page by page. Anyway, it's pretty revolutionary. But it will take us a while to get through the whole run of it and keep up on it. But we've started.
How far back are we going to go?
We started at the beginning.
Which is?
1972. So we have 72 through 78.
That's great.
Yeah.
Because it's a little on the website.
I'll say. Do we have a link on our website? Yep. Eventually.
Look tomorrow after 10 a.m. Don't look at 8:30. Uh-huh. It'll be there on the front page.
Super.
Yeah.
Nice going.
Yeah, that's great.
You know, it took me hours to go through and find out things on the microfilm.
Mm-hmm.
So it'd be great to just put a name in and pop and go back to the date.
What a service to the town.
Mm-hmm. We should maybe publicize once it's finished.
Mm-hmm.
Publicize that
yeah.
so that the whole Ulster County community knows, for researers and historians.
Not just the Ulster County community.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The timing is just based on getting the money.
Mm-hmm. Oh, is it expensive?
It's about $90 per microfilm reel, and each year is about 2 reels, so in the end, it's about $8,000. Mm-hmm. They host it, they set up this website, and they host it. They also, when they scan it, they also send back a separate hard drive with the whole run of it on it that's in our possession. Mm-hmm. And when we send more microfilm reels, we send back the hard drive, they put it on, and then they send it back to us. So that's our backup copy,
mm-hmm.
Should the internet explode.
And is there a yearly fee?
There's a small maintenance fee to the website. There's a one-time setup fee for the website, and then the maintenance is like $50 a year. And we got a locked-in rate of $90 per reel for the scanning,
mm-hmm.
which is good, through the whole run.
And what's the relationship between us and Ulster Publishing on this matter?
Well, I emailed Getty and Brian to tell them the good news, and Getty said, that's great. I'm surprised anyone would be interested. He has a different view of the importance of it. He said, I'm flattered anyone would be interested in searching about old Woodstock or something like that. So, I mean, and they still own it. It's not like we can sell the whole run to ProQuest and build a new library or something, But we get a lot of reference questions that are based on the Woodstock Times, so this is, it's really great.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
I think I didn't that out. The Friends are doing a holiday raffle. They're going to raffle off the bike that they raffled off at the library fair. The winner didn't want the bike, so we're redoing it. It's a really nice bike. It's in the art book room right now. It retails for $650. The raffle tickets for the bike are $5, and then they're also raffling off the quilt that didn't sell on eBay, and those are $10 a piece.
What a lovely idea, raffle the same thing off over and over.
And the drawing will be on December 13th. And next month I'll be bringing tickets so we can all buy some.
Okay. And the quilt's on display.
The quilt's on display behind the circulation desk, and it's quite lovely. Live at the library starts again on Saturday. Maybe Julie can tell us who's performing.
This Saturday it will be Barbara Dempsey and company, and Ron Menninger. And they're having a guest host because I actually have gigs somewhere else. So Terry Massardo will be hosting it. Barry's going to be here videotaping. And Jen Guzman from The Friends is going to come as well, just to help Terry out with snacks and all that kind of stuff, since I'm not going to be here. So it should be a great show. Barbara, they're both really wonderful. I've heard them both. They're really fabulous. So unless you want to come to hear to Poughkeepsie to hear me and Lori, you should definitely come to the library on Saturday.
Thank you
so
much.
Those are the two choices.
Yeah. Okay.
It's such a gift to the library, Julie. Thank you a lot.
You're welcome.
They have the forum schedule set for winter. Saturday, people are going to have to make some hard decisions because this Saturday, Gail Godwin's doing a reading, which is, she doesn't do a lot of that, so it's a really big deal, but it's also film festival weekend, and, you know, so there's a lot of things to do. Our very own Michael Perkins is going to have a reading and book launching party for his latest book in November.
Oh, okay. Oh, the Pocket Perkins.
Yep.
Uh-oh.
Sorry. Oh, pass that over. Doris didn't get one.
You can read off of this one.
That's okay. I wanted to point this out. I have one more thing, but I
don't know. Spinner's going to be here.
All the forums are posted on our website and promoted on our Facebook page. We also put them in external calendars like the Watershed Post and Ulster County Alive, and Chronogram online, and I think the radio also. So the next thing I'm handing out is I wanted to show you some statistics about ebooks. We've been offering downloadable ebooks since 2010, and in 2010 at Woodstock, 5 ebooks were checked out. By 2011 it was 365, and now we're up to 1,482 already this year. So it's still growing. People are still getting devices, and a lot of times, sorry, I switched it up on you and gave you another piece of paper. Many times with the overdrive, the popular books still have holds on them, just like print books, because you don't actually own the content, you are just paying for a license for it. So. It's a demand that is hard to keep up with, but the system-wide, everybody's committed to it. And then there's just some graphs to show you the trends of it increasing, and December's usually really busy. Everybody gets a device for Christmas.
Can you confirm, Amy, that you said 1,480 rather than 14,000?
1,482.
Oh, I see. Yeah. I see it there.
Yeah.
I see here there's an extra zero.
This is system-wide. The
oh,
graphs
okay.
are system-wide.
And now I
sorry,
get
that's not labeled.
Uh-huh.
System, like for the whole...
The whole Main Hudson Library system.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. it's getting easier and easier. I don't know if anybody actually does this, but now it's on your device, it's app-driven, and it's, you know, in the olden times, like 3 years ago, you had to put it on your computer, and then you had to move it on your thing, and it was, now it's a breeze.
So in other words, we're 10% of the whole Mid-Hudson library system?
For e-book checkout.
For e-book checkout?
Wow.
That's very impressive.
Yep.
It's very impressive.
That's all.
Any questions or comments, Jeffrey?
I have a question.
Thanks, Amy.
I would like to know how many FOIL requests you've gotten this month?
I don't know how many I've gotten this month, but since the beginning of the year, the library has received about 44 FOIL requests since January.
And do you know how many FOIL requests the library has had in the past 10 years?
I know from the previous director that over her tenure when the library was a public district, which would be 14 years, the library received 10 FOIL requests in those years.
Okay. So this is really unusual?
I've asked other libraries and, you know, the Poughkeepsie Public Library District, they have a multi-million dollar budget. They do multi-million dollar projects. They've had 2 in the past 17 years.
So, I really wish it was funny. I really wish it was funny. Because my thought process, you know, when this first, let me ask you one more question. Is this interfering with your being the director?
Well, I mean, part of my job is to be the records access officer, and that's great. You know, the library is committed to free and open access to information. You know, librarians love the Freedom of Information Law. It takes time, and it takes energy.
So it's taking time away from your managing the daily, you know, activities here in the library, and your job is—it's
adding a new layer.
Mm-hmm. So, and I've been hearing about all these FOIL requests, and at first I thought, okay, you know, FOILing is legal, and it's everybody's right, just like we have First Amendment rights. But there comes a point where even before it was 44, I was thinking, well, this is really being used as a form of harassment. Before it was the harassment, I thought it was phishing. So it went from FOILing, I thought, to phishing. People were phishing for looking for things that we were tripped up on and we did illegally. And now I feel that it's almost like a form of harassment to be getting so many, and with no disrespect to the people who are FOILing, really. I just want everybody to know that it takes a toll, and it costs the taxpayers money because it's taking hard times and energy. And I brought it up because I was thinking that if this continues, it would be a good idea for us to start thinking about hiring a part-time FOIL person that can do this job for Amy, so that Amy can conduct the business of this library, which like in my letter to the editor this month, statistically does more with less. And I really would hate to see the programming and what goes on in this library hindered by too many FOILs. So that's, you know, why I'm bringing this up right now, and I'm bringing it up because this has to do with her being the director of the library. So, I mean, if anybody has anything to add or say about it, great. If not, I think it's something I'm going to look at next month, and I might even make a motion to hire a part-time FOIL person.
I just want to add that it's all perfectly legal and fine behavior, but when you don't get the director's report in time, that's what's happening. I mean, as far as time management goes and the schedule of the day, this kind of activity has never really been figured in before, so things are kind of shifting. And
I wondered if you can calculate the actual time that it does take to answer a FOIA request. And so we'd have that as part, not just the number 44, mm-hmm. but how many hours that needs.
So. Yeah, we should have kept that.
I would imagine it's different for different FOIA requests.
Right.
I mean, some things take more research than others.
Yep.
So I'm getting a little timer for the future.
Right.
I mean, you know, it would be nice if we didn't have to think about this. You know, I mean, that would be where I would like this to go. And I also think that Amy's very approachable. Anybody can approach Amy at any time for any information. Probably without a FOIA request.
Well, there's a certain formality to the FOIL that I think is appropriate. You know, it kind of, you know, in a way, sometimes people show up and say, I want to see this, this, and this, like, right now. And FOIL sets up a way that people can say, I want to see these things, and it gives you time to actually do them, and you're not doing it on the spot. And that's a really good part of it, you know. But I'm happy to talk to anybody about anything.
Thank you, Amy.
Thanks.
Any further comments or questions for the director's report? Thanks, Amy. Now we're on to committee reports. First one is the Facilities Task Force, which I will start the report. Barry Miller and Elaine are both on the Facilities Task Force and can supplement it or correct me when I make a mistake. The Facilities Task Force has met three times since our last board meeting. And it's meeting pretty regularly on Tuesdays at 5:30 here in the library. But on September 30th, we met at 5:30 in the town hall and had an advertised public be heard, which was early in the agenda, and it ran for the whole agenda. Our normal meetings end at 8 o'clock, but the public be heard went on, and with the approval of the Facilities Task Force, we were almost at 9 o'clock before we finished up there. Many of the board members were present, and the whole meeting is, there's an audio record of it on the library's YouTube channel if you want details. I'm going to try a brief summary of a couple of things. Sam Magarelli proposed something like Joe Mangan's post and beam building in the back. Vince Cristoforo reminded us not to take his land and his parking lot for granted. And many other people, said things that they've already said before, either to us or in the newspaper. So that's my summary of how the public meeting went. I'm looking around, Kathleen.
I like that summary. How many hours?
It was less than four. It was about three and a half. We didn't get to any further business that night on the agenda. But the Facilities Task Force has established a subcommittee, which is looking into practical approaches to building more square feet. The Facilities Task Force has taken as a given the need developed in our 2007 needs assessment that the library needs about 6,000 more square feet than it has now here. And the subcommittee is thinking about various ways that could be achieved and potential or possible costs of different ways of achieving more. Things like adding one or two wings to this present building, or building something across the street, or building the annex across the street. They've taken the annex price into account, as well as general pricing of other kinds of buildings. Subcommittee is working with what they call a practical construction cost between $250 and $350 a square foot for reasonable public construction. And this is just the construction cost after paying for the design and before paying for putting anything in the building, but construction costs along those lines. And they have reached a tentative conclusion, at least that's been reported to the Facilities Task Force, I'm not on the subcommittee, that it would cost about the same to either build 6,000 square feet in one or more wings on this building, or to build that with wings on this building and an 1,100 square foot building across the street that's the size of the laundromat. Those would cost something comparable to build. There's no thought, we haven't any recommendation, we haven't any ideas about what's the best way to do it, but that's a tentative conclusion. I think the subcommittee, either the subcommittee or the Facilities Task Force, will then take a look at the question of what other costs are there? What else does the library need? The subcommittee has already said that that we should figure something like $25 a square foot or $220,000 to refurbish this present building as part of any other construction project. And that could be for different things depending on what we would build. And not to give you play-by-play of everything we talk about at the Facilities Task Force, but last Tuesday, Esther Ratner led us in an interesting discussion about the future of libraries. And we all talked about that. Amy, of course, participated, and Joe Mangan has shown some pictures of some technical aspects that we've been thinking about, like a little recording studio or a little movie editing studio, those kinds of things that he's put into other buildings. So that's my summary of where the Facilities Task Force is now, and I invite anyone to ask questions, but particularly Barry and Elaine, you want to say anything?
Well, the subcommittee did meet today, and we continued our discussions on what to do to the property. We're not just looking across the street, we're not just looking at the back, and we're not just looking at the wings. We're looking at the entire campus of the library. And one of the discussions that we're having is that we would like to put a building in the back where the barn is and possibly get the stacks out of here because of the weight on the floor in this building. It's an older building. It can hold the stacks, but it would be better if it was in a newer building and where people can come in here, and then we can work on different sections of this building at different times and improve whatever shortcomings this building has. But we're working, you know, we're talking about all the options, and we're not taking anything off the table. We're throwing in as much information as we can to come to conclusions.
One thing that that I wanted to make sure everybody knew was that I keep reminding them we need to maintain the function of the Friends of the Library barn in some way, shape, or form. So we've been trying to build that into the plan.
Thank you both, Elaine and Barry. And are there any other questions?
Just a question. Will there be any attempt to update that 7-year-old 6,000 square foot number? I mean, is there any reason to believe that in the light of the changes of the use of the library and libraries over the last 7 years, that number is still sacrosanct?
I mean, 6,000 square feet seems...
Well, the facilities task force is working with that
right,
number.
Right, that's the number that
we're
working with.
And it's up to us if we want to
and
do something
it has nothing
about
to do, it. It has nothing to do with making this building 6,000 square feet. It has to do with possibly 1,000, 5,000, you know, splitting it up, maybe putting an addition on the front. We have to enlarge the front, the front entrance. That's one of the things that's kind of in the mix. You have to make it a little more ADA compliant. So the doorway has to be made larger. So the actual front of the library may be adjusted in some way. Again, nothing has been decided yet. It's a thought that we've had, and it's something that is in the mixer with everything else.
But to answer your question specifically, the facilities task force is not going to address that question.
Okay.
We've asked the library board, asked them to consider that as what the library's needs were. When they make a recommendation to the library board about how to meet those needs, a 6,000-foot expansion, the library board can decide, will decide what to do next, and it could include, likely if an architect's involved, an updating of the library program.
I mean, that's a
logical thing, but who knows? Go ahead, Barry.
One of the things that we're working with on Matrix, everybody's who's doing research is bringing to us a matrix that say, well, we have this option, we could do this, and we need this. Amy has given us a number of different how much room do we need for computers? How much room do we need for books? How much room do we need for children's programs? So we take all these things, and we've got matrix that we can put all these things against so that we can figure out where something would work best.
However, the facilities task force will not be designing a library addition.
From the meetings I attended, I had the impression, Amy, that when you had updated, you know, I had the impression that the 6,000 square foot estimate of additional space we needed from 2007 was still pretty valid in terms of the program needs of the library, and that you had updated the FTF with
contemporary
needs.
I did, and I also made it
needs.
Clear that I did it in my office in a vacuum
right.
without the amount of focus groups and community outreach that the other plan involved, and I suggested if that was the route that the library board was going to go, that all that whole process needed to be redone. Things have changed, community's changed.
I also just wanted to say from the meetings I've attended and hearing the reports of the subcommittee, I've just been very impressed with the huge amount of time and energy that all the volunteers on the task force are donating to this. I mean, people meeting several times a week and doing outside research and just a huge commitment and dedication. So I found that very inspiring.
Thanks, Dorothea. Any more on this subject? Next report, planning. Katrina.
Well, this isn't part of my committee, but I'm involved in it with the story walk for Halloween night for the little kids. It's a non-scary Halloween celebration after the town is out of candy.
Walk up the sugar.
Yeah. So I think it's going to start around 6 o'clock, and it'll start outside, and then there'll be different stories, like 5 or 6 different storytellers inside. So if you know any little kids, appropriate till about 8 or 9 years old. I guess the Playhouse is doing something for older kids that's scary. And on the 25th, if you know little kids, there is a special fairy house for winter and fall. It's made out of pumpkins and gourds, making fairy houses from 2 to 4, the 25th. So we need kids, because those little fairy houses are then going to be lit up and put outside as part to delineate the walkway to the library. So it's, or if anybody wants to make a fairy house out of a pumpkin and bring it in, that's fine too. So that's what we're doing. And if anybody wants to volunteer or help out in any way, contact Leslie Sawhill. She's in charge.
Jeffrey.
Did
first.
Have you ever done anything with children that didn't involve fairies?
She loves a fairy house.
Yes, the first year we did a float.
No fairies?
No, just a horse.
A few of the kids that came just as good.
Yes, but it wasn't my...
I think that's such an interesting approach, a change to carve pumpkins instead of making scary faces, make fairy houses. Another whole way about it. Anything more about planning?
Not yet.
Okay, public relations, Barry. Where's the TV coming?
Well, I'm working on the next show. I did an interview this week with Brent Robeson and his wife Wendy and their daughter, Okancha. And depending on how many segments I have, one or all of them will be on the show. And just moving along, I'm setting up video dates with other people to do video recording. So I haven't started working on the next show yet, but just accumulating videotape at this point.
Do you want to mention about the separate
channel? Oh yeah, we're starting to separate the board meetings and the voice cloud stuff from the TV show. So the TV show will be lined up on one channel, so it's just a TV show, and then the board meetings and other meetings that Thomas is doing, and the voice cloud will be on another channel. it's a lot cleaner that way if you're looking for something that you want to watch.
You mean on the TV?
On YouTube.
On YouTube.
Yeah.
Okay.
On the library's YouTube. It has one YouTube channel, or it used to have one YouTube channel, now it has two.
I do have one thing I want to say.
Yes.
If there's anybody, either on the board or in the audience, that knows anybody who would like to be in What Book Are You Reading, all you have to do is tell them to come to the library and leave their name with Amy and their phone number. I will give them a call. I can set up a video date for them. I'd like to get as many people in the community as involved as possible. I'd love to find more writers. I mean, there are a lot of writers in town.
I think you should hit Gail Gaffin up for
mm-hmm. Well, Gail, yeah, like, Gail, well...
I'd like to know what she's reading.
Yeah, we've been to her house. But,
Better than Morta?
Huh?
Better than Morta?
Well, I'm still waiting for, you know, everything to smooth out over there before I encroach. He's still healing. Yeah, he's still healing. So I'd like to, you know, I'm putting that out there if anybody knows anything. And another thing, if there's ever anything you're planning, see, if I would have remembered, because I'm so involved with the task force and I forget other things going on. But if there's something going on some month, I have to know a month ahead of time to get it on the TV show so it's not on afterwards. So I could have put Halloween on this month to let people know that there's a Halloween event. So I guess I'll be working on the Christmas events with Leslie for you know future events.
That'd be a good idea.
But if anybody knows of any events going on that are happening in the library and you'd like to be on the show, let me know.
Thanks. I think it's a really useful thing that you're doing. We're up past the anniversary.
Mm. 1 year.
You've been doing it more than a year.
I'm up to show 18.
Yeah. A year and a half.
Yeah.
Anything else about public relations? Thank you, Barry. Now, on to these policies. They were sent out, I think, before.
Sheila's on screen. Wait at the end of the month or something.
You can watch the television.
I can watch the television.
The video, right.
Amy, do you have some copies for the audience?
Yeah. I don't. They were posted on the website days ago.
Maybe some extras here.
Pardon?
No, we have a couple of extras.
Oh, okay. let's see, Elaine and Barry, do you want to tee up the conversation?
Okay, I'll start. Barry will finish. First of all, we should say that we need to do this because there's a requirement for new policies, not just the ones we have, but a whole other subject. And Amy has a list if anybody wants to know which ones. So we just did these for now.
You mean the state or the library system?
Yeah.
It's the library system, isn't it?
Well, the conflict of interest policy is a requirement of the Non-For-Profit Revitalization Act, period, not question mark.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's a new requirement, and the other ones are ones that we just need to have. That we don't have in one of them is a
And where did the new expectations come from?
Both the system and the state.
The system and the state.
May I suggest that as a process in that we go through them one at a time.
Right.
So we could start with the front of it and then discuss it and then vote on it and then move on to the next one.
Should we start with conflict of interest? That's on the top.
Mm-hmm. And that's logical.
Is this one of those we had? No. Which one do we have signed? Does that mean...
That was the ethics one.
It was just the ethics one.
Right. The conflict of interest policy, very few places are in compliance now with the new law. NYLA, the New York Library Association, is one of the first to complete their conflict of interest policy that passed legal review and so on and so forth. So... libraries are kind of in the habit of sharing policies, copying policies, that kind of thing. We don't reinvent the wheel, especially if we know it's already been vetted through lawyers. So this was initially written for the Library Association. We changed it to have it go towards the library district.
Is there any discussion?
It seems pretty straightforward.
Yeah, I hope it's complete. That's a good part about getting it from the system from other libraries. But we hope that it covers everything we need to cover. But don't forget, we review our policies every year. So if things change or the workings turn out not to be so easy, then we could change it. Or we could change it any time.
Yeah.
And also, some policies are more dense than others. In other words, the legal language that they're written with is a little more difficult to understand. So this conflict of interest policy, we spent a lot of time reading through because it's pretty dense, and it kind of covers, it dots all the I's and crosses all the T's.
Mm-hmm.
And we wanted to make sure that he's doing that.
And you know, it does state at the end that you would sign a statement that if you've received a copy of it and have read and understood it annually.
Yes. Yes.
There's just no underline there.
There's no underline.
I see it at the bottom of.
Mm-hmm. The ethics statement.
It says a covered person shall.
I have read the attached conflict of interest.
And it defines a covered person as someone who receives compensation.
No,
or
any member of the Woodstock Board of Trustees.
Oh, is that
an employee? Covered person.
The key to it is disclosure. If anyone thinks that they have what could even appear to be a conflict of interest, they disclose it. And then we can talk about whether it's a real conflict of interest or not, whether it's would be a problem for the library or not. And as long as it's all being done in public, we deal with it appropriately. Well, that's a summary of what it says. And the annual statement says that everybody has looked at it once a year and remembers what it is. It doesn't even say they remember what it is. It says they looked at it once a
year. Just they read it and signed it.
Yeah.
Having worked for the state for a long time, I know that if you don't sign it, if it's not documented, it's not done.
Mm-hmm.
So if you sign it, then you can't say that you didn't know about it or didn't think it. So
if we adopt this, probably we'd have a signing of the conflict of interest policy at our organizational meeting each January. Just
that.
Add that to the agenda, something like that. So is
exactly,
there any?
We said that at the Board of Trustees ethics statement. We said, I will sign the statement at the beginning of my term.
Mm-hmm. And that's just once a term.
And the one above that. So I'll read the.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not just internal, I shouldn't say, I don't know if that's a good word, internal. Let's say somebody on the board, let's say we need something done to the building, and somebody on the board says, I have a friend who can do that real cheap. That's a conflict of interest. So it also has to do with people that we hire not being related or connected to people on the board. So it's not just what we're doing, but it's also the community as well in terms of any connection or attachment to the library that they might have.
Well, that's not exactly that way. A covered person doesn't mean everybody that any board member knows. The covered persons or the interested persons are pretty well defined up there in the definitions.
Mm-hmm.
If it seems as though there's a problem along the lines that you mentioned, and somebody on the board wants to raise it, they certainly can, and we can discuss it. And we should discuss it if it looks like there's a difficulty. But it doesn't mean that no friend of any board member can do anything for the library, or that it raises a conflict of interest for that board member.
We always take volunteers.
Yeah.
There's never a conflict of interest in volunteers.
So are we going to vote on this particular conflict of interest policy?
Yes, at least I hope somebody will move. It's been presented by the policy committee for us to adopt tonight, this first one, this conflict of interest.
Well, I think if it's fine to me, I would make a motion to accept it as it is with the signing,
uh-huh.
So that every member signs this every year.
Mm-hmm.
I'll second it.
Okay, so it's moved by Jeffrey and seconded by Barry Miller to... just a second, I'll call for discussion. To approve the conflict of interest policy with a signature line and date at the bottom, a blank for a date. And now, is there any further discussion, Katrina?
But you just said that with a sign for the date. Okay, no, we do it every year, right?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
At least that's what the last clause says.
I have a question about my motion.
Okay.
Do we need to have this witnessed?
No.
So does it mean it doesn't have to be a
no.
It doesn't have to be notarized.
Neither notarized nor witnessed. Just want to make sure we're on the up and up here.
Any further discussion about the conflict of interest policy? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. The next one. Credit card.
This is a new one for us. We have a credit card through TD Bank. It has a limit of $500. It's mostly used for online purchases. I'm the only one that can sign. My name's on it. It's stored in the safe. Just what it says. We pay the balance in full every month.
This is pretty much the existing policy.
We never had it before.
But I mean,
it's
this
new.
Is what you did.
Yeah, it's just...
Okay.
Yeah.
It's just...
Yes.
I move that we accept this policy.
I second.
Well, let's see. It's moved by Barry Miller. Seconded
Barry Samuels.
Barry Miller. Moved by Barry Samuels. Seconded by Elaine. I heard it second came in second over here. So, to adopt the credit card policy. And is there any discussion, Jeffrey?
$500 doesn't seem like a lot of money to me. And we have a
max it out all the time.
Yeah,
I don't know. You know, I mean, I you know, in my business, I make purchases all the time online. Mm-hmm. $500, we never. What is your authority to spend money without the board's approval? You know, you have your discretionary.
Yeah, I mean,
so
you know, within the budget.
What is that budget?
Well, the whole budget.
Not the whole budget.
I mean, we have the credit card, which is a $500 limit. We also have a petty cash, which is $150 for those, you know.
And we have a procurement policy.
Yeah, I think what he's asking
you're getting
is
so
how
much
can you spend without approval of the board to use the card?
Oh, to use the card?
Under the procurement policy.
You need something, you're going to use the card to buy books or whatever.
No, forget about the card. You need something.
You mean big
You don't need, how much money can you spend without the board's approval?
The policy says if it's over $5,000, I need to get 3 written estimates, and the library director makes the decision. If it's $10,000 or more, I have to get 3 written estimates, and then I have to bring it to the building committee and to get approval before I do it.
I would just like to suggest that you amend it and raise it to $1,000. That you amend your motion and raise it to $1,000. That's
what
I would.
For the credit card.
That's what I would suggest. Well, the credit card.
Just the credit.
Well, she can
sure.
Not just use
would
it online.
Would that make it easier for you? I mean, would that make life in the library better because you're not scrambling around going petty cash, my credit card? Because this is once a month, right?
Right.
Is it once a month?
It's fine at $500. I don't want it floating around and, you know, my name's on it, and $500's fine, really.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
I appreciate it, but $500's good. Feel comfortable with that.
Thanks, Jeffrey. Is there further discussion of this motion to approve the credit card policy?
I'll make a motion to accept it.
We have a motion made by
and
seconded by Elaine. And I bungled the first time I said who had made the motion, but I got it right with your help. Any further discussion? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The motion carries. Next.
Okay, we're up to the ethics
statement. You recall that we've heard comments about this already this evening?
Paragraph 4 is the key.
So.
Question for Elaine.
Sure.
Is this more or less what other libraries allow?
Well, this is also based on the trustee handbook,
right?
Which says the same thing in a different way. This
right.
is a little more succinct.
Right.
As John pointed out, it's based on the East Fishkill ethics policy. Mid-Hudson Library System has a policy page with samples from other public libraries that, like I said before.
Right, that's what I was thinking.
Mm-hmm. But there's a precedent. It's in the
handbook.
Right, in the handbook.
I would like to say something about that.
Of course.
I kind of liked it when it was more explicit. It's kind of short. It got shortened, didn't it?